Each year, Lawrence University seeks to recognize a person of distinction and accomplishment by awarding an honorary degree.
Mr. President, it is my honor to present Lan Samantha Chang for the honorary degree, Doctor of Humane Letters.
Lan Samantha Chang, spellbinding writer and dedicated educator, you have demonstrated a devotion to the beauty and power of the written word, a commitment to your craft that we hope Laurentians will emulate wherever their lives take them. You have called Lawrence the center of intellectual life in Appleton, and we are honored to bring you back home. You grew up here after your parents immigrated to the United States from China in the 1950s to attend college. Your mother earned a Bachelor of Music in Piano Pedagogy from Lawrence and shared the joy of playing the piano with hundreds of Appleton children, while your father was an associate professor of engineering at the Institute for Paper Chemistry. Your love of writing blossomed here in Appleton's public school system. You earned degrees from two Ivy League institutions, Yale and Harvard universities, before returning to your true passion at the Iowa Writers' Workshop. Now you lead that same renowned writing workshop, the oldest creative writing degree program in the country, where you nurture, challenge, and inspire promising novelists, poets, and short story writers who hope to mirror your success. Through your books, you have given us essential glimpses into the human experience. Indeed, the New York Times called your first book, Hunger, a taut, incisive study of Chinese immigrants in America and their almost wordless struggle to adapt to a new life. In your 2004 novel, Inheritance, you explored the emotional intricacies of two sisters' fractured relationship. Your most recent book, All is Forgotten, Nothing is Lost, reveals the trappings of ambition and insecurity through the eyes of fledgling poets. Your writing reminds us of the complexities of human minds, hearts, and souls. In recognition of your accomplishments and the extent to which you represent the spirit and letter of the Lawrence University educational mission, and by the authority vested in me, I now confer upon you the degree Doctor of Humane Letters, honoris causa, and admit you to its rights, privileges, and obligations.
Greetings to parents, friends, family, and Lawrence University's class of 2016. It is a privilege to stand before you. You look beautiful. Being asked to give a commencement speech is a tremendous honor, and it's also a sign that one has reached, shall we say, a rather advanced age. It's time to review one's life, and for me, it's been a pleasure to look back at a childhood spent here in Appleton and at my family's meaningful ties to Lawrence University. Thank you, Professor Burstein, for inviting me to speak here. Commencement is a major transition, a single event that changes life irrevocably. Graduating, like participating in a marriage ceremony or waiting for the birth of a child, can feel like sitting on a high-speed train shooting through a tunnel. You are required only to be present for the change to occur. You cannot get off the train, and you will emerge from the tunnel in the light of a new place. Never again will you have so many unanswered questions. Never again will so much of the future be unclear. You are on the brink of your life, and you may not know what kind of life it will be, how you will make a living, where you will be living, who you will be living with. Depending on who you are, you may feel excited about this lack of clarity, or if you're at all like the way I was, you may feel a sense of unease. You may wish that you could pop into the future just to make sure that it will all work out. And who knows, maybe you will be able to do this. Going to the past or future has become such a part of the cultural zeitgeist that my 9-year-old daughter keeps a backpack in her room filled with items to use in case she needs to travel through time. More likely, instead of a backpack, you are stuck with a set of unanswerable questions. Possibly you have formulated a statement to trot out in case some well-meaning relative, friend, or stranger asks you what you're planning to do after graduation. I plan to go to law school, you will say, or I want to travel and then apply for a master's degree, or the most challenging of all answers, I have no idea. We are living in a society where there's a great deal of pressure to be on some kind of track. A track seems to eliminate risk and provides the comfort of certainty ahead. A track is linear. It is causal and it is definite. A track is a promise. A leads to B, B leads to C, and eventually if we keep going and don't look up, we know we will arrive somewhere. And yet, my advice to you today is to plan for surprises. Make room for surprises because they are perhaps the only sure thing. As a person who once liked things to be planned out, I can assure you that this is true. When I look back on the last 3 decades, I can see that despite my best efforts, I have lived an unplanned life. What I am doing now makes me very happy, but it is nothing like what I thought I would or should be doing. I always wanted to be a novelist, but no one is more surprised that I actually became one. On the most productive and meaningful days of my adult existence, I spend hours in a chair, staring out of my second floor window into the neat green lawns of my neighbors, contemplating the troubles of characters who do not exist, frequently deleting more words than I type. In addition, I direct an academic program, the University of Iowa Writers Workshop, where I join my colleagues and creative predecessors in encouraging and supporting gifted younger writers in their own efforts to sit for hours doing what looks very much like nothing. So you could say that Lawrence University has made an admirably bold choice in exposing you, its brilliant and impressionable young graduates, to my advice. Moreover, I'm a past master at ignoring advice from knowledgeable people. My late mother and my father, who emigrated from mainland China about 60 years ago amid the tumult and political violence following World War II, lived through terrifying, even traumatizing experiences. My parents survived war, isolation, emigration, and exile, and they put a lot of effort into and time on, literally sacrificed them for, as they frequently reminded my 3 sisters and me, our security, our education, our future lives in America. They had a superabundance of life knowledge upon which to draw when they tried to give us the benefit of their wisdom. My father, in particular, found it distressing to watch me, in particular, as I went about my childhood and adolescence in a fog. Alone of his 4 daughters, I was incompetent. I was a space cadet, and perhaps worst of all, I had a tendency to ignore what I was told. I spent my time buried in novels. My parents were able to confiscate the most frivolous of these novels, but they could not change my occasional whiny existence that I wanted to do something artistic with my life. I wanted to be a writer, had wanted to write since I was 4 years old. My father, an engineer, frequently tried to pierce the bubble of self-delusion. His favorite place to do this was in the family car, from which it was impossible to escape. As you know, I was born and raised right here in Appleton, so please imagine yourselves in 1977 cruising in a boat-like sea green Ford station wagon up College Avenue several decades ago. Perhaps we're headed to an event, a recital at the conservatory. My father had and still has a sonorous, musical baritone voice. It was impossible to shut him out, although I tried many tactics such as quiet humming, reciting multiplication tables, or timing how long I could hold my breath. Forget about happiness, my father would say. Americans are always talking about happiness. One of his best topics was real life, nasty, brutish, and short. You must have a profession, he thundered at the windshield. These lectures were occasionally delivered in Mandarin and, when he worried I wasn't listening or understanding, English. The many hours he spent on me were part of his attempt to persuade me to become a doctor. This suggestion was, of course, practical, even excellent advice. Like many immigrants before him, my father's choice on this career was founded on hard realism. My parents' circumstances were entirely shaped by a military invasion and events of violence entirely beyond their control. They had seen firsthand what happened to a society when things fall apart. The crucial job, the only surviving profession in the midst of war, is medicine. People will always pay the doctor because nobody wants to die. My parents had seen people die. They had seen much more than I had seen. Medicine is secure. When my mother and father met and married, they had no resources. Each had left China in 1949 and had struggled before coming to the US without parental support. My mother's father died the year she finished high school. She arrived in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, later that year with two suitcases and a dictionary. My father left his family at 18, escaping the Japanese occupation on foot. He never returned to his home. In the turbulence of post-war China, his mother and father vanished behind the communist bamboo curtain, and he never saw them again. My parents came to this country. They wanted us, their children, to establish ourselves, to be safe here in America. On these matters, my late mother's favorite English phrase was comfortable. I would like you to be comfortable, she said. Too bad for her. I had no idea what she meant. She seemed to think of adult life as being in a bed or upholstered chair. If you become a doctor, you will be comfortable. To which these ideas were added that if I was successful enough at my profession, I could pursue other more impractical interests as hobbies. That if I made enough money, I could also help make her life more comfortable. It was the old buy your mother a house argument. Other arguments were that so-and-so's son or daughter did this or that and their families benefited. So-and-so had failed and her mother was in disgrace. How could I do that to my mother? Hadn't my mother and father been through enough getting us all to the point where we were? Didn't they sacrifice enough every day? Yes, they did. The problem with my parents and their advice was that they were essentially right. It made sense to go for a future in which I would have a profession, a way of making a good living, a base from which to do creative work. So, when I graduated from Appleton High School West, I tried to follow their wishes, tried many times and did not succeed. I applied to college stating that I wanted to be a physician, a dermatologist specifically, since I had once had a rash. The first year of freshman chemistry made it clear to me that I had no hope in this career. I had absolutely no interest in it. What do you do when the thing you've thought you should do since you can remember, the comforting goal you had always used when people asked you what you wanted to do with your life, is not a possibility? I applied to law school. I applied and was admitted, but discovered I could not bring myself to enroll. What then? Well, the only activity I really knew about was reading. So I took a very underpaid job as an editorial assistant at Random House, Inc. in New York. The salary was so low that we were not expected to live on it. The other editorial assistants were paying their rent with income from investments their parents had made from them. They had, as one of them put it, other sources of income. This was 1987, and in Manhattan, a bagel with butter was only 30 cents. I ate at least one bagel every day. I had a friend in publishing who was similarly underfunded. She and I earned a few dollars each week selling the books people left on the giveaway shelves near the photocopy machine. We followed hors d'oeuvre trays at book parties. We celebrated our birthdays and kvetched about our problems in the cheapest restaurants in town, where we were surrounded by other impoverished, recent, impractical graduates on cheap first dates. I like animals, and I like Shakespeare, I remember a young woman saying anxiously to her date at a table 4 inches away from me. The desperation in those restaurants was palpable. I was beginning to understand what my mother had meant when she talked about a comfortable life. 2 years out of college, my ambition was to be employed in a job that might support me. I sought the kind of job that would require training, an office job that would require me to wear hose. I scuttled into the best professional school that would admit me, the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University. I chose this K-school out of logic, crossing my fingers that my college journalism and East Asian studies major would get me in it. It seemed like the perfect logical outcome of my studies and activities. But unfortunately, when I arrived at the Kennedy School, I realized that this logic made no sense at all. The Kennedy School is a high-minded place where many good people go to solve the world's problems. My parents talk about society, about war and politics, and the suffering of those without resources had made an impression on me, after all. But in my anxiety to go back to school, I had failed to understand that graduate school is designed to winnow out the extraneous interests from your life and point you toward a specific thing. I was now surrounded by dedicated and passionate people who were willing to devote their lives to making spreadsheets and writing 2-page policy memos. I was interested in the problems themselves, but not in cost-benefit analysis. What was the dollar price of an endangered animal? The price of a human life? The questions made no sense to me. They seemed designed to quantify things that were entirely unquantifiable. Finally, one morning near the end of my first semester at the Kennedy School, I woke up and realized that I simply could not keep lying to myself for one day longer. I had no interest in policy. Simply qualifying for a specific kind of professional training did not mean that I was ultimately suited for that profession. Simply wishing I had an office job did not mean that I was suited for that kind of job. My interest in problems did not lie, I realized, in solving them. It lay in asking questions, in exploring the people, possibly imaginary people, living through the questions. I had run from one profession to another, and it had been out of some kind of terror, some fear of facing the fact that what I truly wished to do was impractical. It was foolish. There, in my safe dormitory room at Harvard, I had to own my impractical desires. I had promised my mother that I would finish my degree, but I decided to spend any spare time in Cambridge following my interests. It was the first time in my life that I had given myself permission to do this. Ultimately, that December, I wandered into the Cambridge Center for Adult Education and enrolled in my very first fiction workshop. I was 25 years old, owed more than $35,000 in student loans, and had taken my first step into the rest of my life. It was then that the surprises began. In the writing class, I was given a set of exercises and discovered that it was possible to spend hours working on them with no internal protests, no resistance. The exercises led to my first short story. The following spring, I was admitted to the Iowa Writers' Workshop, where I discovered a community of people like myself, a community of people for whom writing was the only thing that mattered. Together, for 2 years, we made writing the center of our lives. Perhaps a bigger surprise was that after I graduated from the Kennedy School, moved to Iowa, and was given my first section of freshman composition to teach, I never took out a student loan again. Over the next several years, although I was never in the clear, never financially secure, I was able to support myself from teaching and fellowships, pay off personal debts, pay off all of my student loans with the sale of my first book. I was given a fellowship in California. I bought a used car and drove it all around New England. I traveled a lot more than I ever expected I would, lived in places I'd never known I would live, became a professor, ultimately took on the directorship of the same graduate program that had given me my second life. This directorship was a position that I never in a million years would have dreamed of having. There were stressful moments, missed planes, lost keys, and dented bumpers. There were also moments of happiness, extraordinary happiness, with the excitement of finding myself in an entirely new landscape, basking in the sunlight of latitude I had never experienced before, eating a delicious meal with friends in an expensive restaurant, or more often, more realistically, at a somewhat cheaper restaurant. Perhaps the biggest surprise came when I, who had been single into my mid-30s, met a man, an artist, married at 39 and had a daughter at 42. Now, I'm 51 years old, and there are still turns in the road, still times when I begin to feel as if I'm caught in a circle and then break free, and there are big and wonderful moments, such as this opportunity to talk to all of you. My parents were skeptical, then tolerant, and finally, when I became a professor at 40, proud of me. Meanwhile, perhaps to their surprise and relief, their own efforts had paid off as well. Did my father imagine during his first years as an immigrant living in New York City that he would enjoy becoming a Packers fan? When my mother left mainland China and then Taiwan, did she have any idea that she would eventually earn a second degree here at Lawrence and become a beloved piano teacher? After long years of frugality, anxiety, frustration, and hard work, they sent all four of us to good colleges and graduate schools. My sister Tina became a doctor. Thank you, Tina. She's right there. She's right there in the audience. My mother received recognition for her teaching, and my father was especially relieved when, at last, finally, his daughters began to reproduce. We turned out to be big experts at geriatric pregnancy. My 93-year-old father, who is here today. Thanks, Dad. He's the proud grandfather of six, three girls, and three boys, the oldest having graduated from Amherst College 2 weeks ago. I went to his commencement ceremonies partly out of curiosity to see how a graduation speech was done. One speaker began by pointing out that students are often too stressed and hungover to remember the commencement speaker anyway. Of course, it's hard to keep track of what people are saying when you're going through a moment of significant transition, when you're going through the tunnel. As a new graduate, the life you face will be, in many ways, like the life of an immigrant. You will emerge from this transition in a new place with your childhood behind you, an old country from which you are now separate. From now on, all trips to that place will be only visits. You will be in a new country, the country of your adult life, with new expectations, a new vocabulary, new speakers, new world, and, like an immigrant, you will have nothing to lose. You will launch yourself into the world on the rocket fuel of your own hopes and aspirations, and you will discover many wonderful surprises. What do I wish I had known when I was graduating from college? The answer is quite simple. I wish I had known that it would all work out. If I had known that it would all work out, I would have enjoyed those years a great deal more. And I advise you to do so. Congratulations, class of 2016. I wish you every best thing.